to Babylon, and were gathered together at Shechem, which belonged to Judah, and pitched between Shechem and Ezekah in Ephes-Damim. And Saul and the men of Israel were gathered together and pitched by the valley of Elah, and set the battle in array against the Philistines. And they stood on, and the Philistines stood on a mountain on one side, and Israel stood on mountain on the other side. And there was a valley between them. And there went out a champion out of the camp of the Philistines named Goliath of Gath, whose height was 6 cubits and a span. Okay, let's move to the gate. And he stood and cried unto the armies of Israel and said unto them, why are ye come out to set your battle in array? Am I not a Philistine? And ye servants of Saul, choose you a man for you, and let him come down to me. And if he be able to fight with me and kill me, then you will be your servants. And if I prevail against him and kill him, then shall we be our head. Then shall ye be our servants and servants. And the Philistine said, I defy the army of Israel this day. Give me a man that we may fight together. Let me read the last verse. When you go to the house, you can continue to the last verse, which is in verse 58. So I'm reading 11. Yeah. When Saul and all Israel heard those words of the Philistine, they were dismayed and really afraid. Can you place your right hand on your heart? And then I want you to ask the Lord to speak to you. Ask the Lord to bless you with his word. Ask the Lord to fire you up. Ask the Lord to strengthen you and to empower you in the mighty name of Jesus. Open your mind and pray. Open your mind and pray. In the name of Jesus. Liba suaba la harsia disa. Lulua in plazua ke isa divua. Emense ve inkuao. Ome ke inkuparia. Olo sa isha gatosi tayata. Ompatia inkuula. Ye isa liko toto imani malusata. Le grede iman sotoyo. Le grese ifato payata kata. Le batu. Yele otun sali impatwa katibaya lusa keke olumpayatia. Let your revival fire, oh God, be released into the atmosphere. Let your fire, oh God, be released into this environment. I pray that someone will catch fire before she or he leaves this place. In the mighty name of Jesus, I superimpose your presence over this atmosphere. Let the electromagnetic force of the Holy Spirit take charge over this environment. In the name of Jesus, I hold in check demonic and satanic powers. And I pray that thy fire, oh God, will be imparted into our lives. And after everything is said and done, we'll give you the praise, the adoration, and the honor. In Jesus' powerful and majestic name, we pray with thanksgiving. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Okay. Yesterday, when we were praying, the Lord actually impressed the word on my heart to share with you. And I believe that your life will never remain the same. Amen. Oh, I didn't hear you. Amen. I said your life will never remain the same. The title of my message this evening is God is looking for soldiers. God is looking for soldiers. So look at somebody and tell the person, the Lord is looking for soldiers. You see it with conviction. Hallelujah. I read a book by the name The Final Quest. That book is a very, very, very powerful book. If you get it, buy it by Prophet Rejuana. And then, in the book, Prophet Rejuana had a revelation. And in the revelation, he met Apostle Paul. And then Apostle Paul told him something. And what Apostle Paul said that was that the crowd of witness in heaven hardly recognized the church on earth. And he said that the church had become a phantom of what it used to be in their days. They can't be there, phantom. I said, I say, and shadow. You see, then he said, he's sending him to come and correct something in the church. And what he wanted to come and correct is the message. The message of the church. And then he has to come and preach the message of sacrifice. The message of sacrifice. You see, no kingdom, institution can be established or advanced without sacrifice. There's nothing like that. So you see, Christianity can never advance in this world without God getting people who sacrifice their lives. You know, in 1773, in the history of redemption, the greatest theologian in the American colonial era, and possibly American history, Jonathan Edwards, he predicted in the history of redemption that at the dawn of the 21st century, there is going to be a mighty revival that will start in America and then spread across the nations of the world and actually spell out the end of Islamic religion. But it's like we are not seeing the manifestation of that prophetic word. And the reason why we are not seeing the manifestation of that prophetic word is the fact that Bishop Omar said that prophecy does not work in a vacuum. So even though God wants to do something, but before God will do that thing on this earth, he needs some people that to volunteer themselves as an instrument he can use before he do it. He said, when you look at the world now, do you know that the percentage, the Christian percentage of the world is just 23%? 23%. So, you ask yourself a question that, what about the rest of the percentage? And now the fastest growing religion in the world is not Christianity.
No.
It's Islamic religion. I was watching something, you know, a video, and I was so devastated. It was Muhammad Awad, an Islamic apologetic in U.S., and he said that they want to turn Africa into an Islamic nation, and he have sent some foot soldiers in Africa to make sure they turn this continent into an Islamic nation. And he's actually raising funds, and we have Islamic imams and sheikhs and alajis who are supporting him. And he said that their first target is Nigeria, because Nigeria is the heart of Africa. If they are able to conquer Nigeria, they will conquer the entire continent of Africa. And he actually came and gathered people in a sports stadium. Even I watched one of his videos, and he was in Liberia in a sports stadium, and he had this educated businessman in Islam backing him, giving him the money and giving him the support. Now in Ghana, they have decided to build 1,000 mosques from King Tampo to the three northern regions. And whilst they are so passionate, the way the man was talking, the passion with which he was talking was great. And he said that he went to the U.S. in 1983 to look for money. And then when he went there, he heard Ahmed Dida talk talking and he decided to abandon his ambition and learn Islamic apologetics to fight Christianity and do something for Islam. For from 1983, he had decided to lay down his life for the cause of Islam. And he had even debated most of the powerful Christian apologetics. Sometimes when I listen to some of his debate, it breaks my heart. Some of the things he would say, he said vociferously with so much passion. You know, the problem in our world now is that those people that belong to the fraternity of the world, or those people that belong to the dark kingdom, they are so passionate. But those of us who are in the kingdom of light are so we are so callous. Some of us are so apathetic. Some of us are so passive. Some of us lack passion, and that is why darkness is covering the earth. Edmund Burke, the Irish poet, said something. He said that the only ingredient necessary for the triumph of evil is when good people does nothing. And then William Batraeus, in his book, The Second Coming, he said that things are falling apart. And he said the reason why things are falling apart is that whilst the best people of the world lacks conviction, the worst people of the world are full of passionate intensity. We have one Islamic fundamentalist who are ready to put a bomb on themselves and die for their religion. Yeah. Osama bin Laden and his guys, they left their comfort zone and then bundled themselves in the Tolaboa hill, and they stayed there to develop themselves, to sophisticate themselves, to build themselves, and to die for Islam. And one of the things you have to understand is that, you see, Osama bin Laden and his guys, these guys were not dummies. These guys were guys who were intellectually sophisticated. Some of them were engineers. Some of them were pilots. Answer of the crowd, and they called aviation school. Actually, a two-plane. The person have to pay a lot of, you know, thousands of dollars. And these people have to, you know, disconfix themselves. These people have to sacrifice and invest thousands of dollars to develop their intellect, to build capacity, not to do anything but to die for their religion. Yes. And God, Jesus, is looking for people who also come out of their comfort zone and fight for the kingdom. When we read, the Bible said that there was a battle, a constant battle between the Philistines and the children of Israel. You got to understand that there is a battle between the kingdom of light and the kingdom of darkness. And you see, it is so sad and pathetic that a lot of Christians are living our lives as if there is nothing at stake. The world is sinking in darkness. The enemy is almost taking over the world. The enemy is fighting. The world is fighting. Other religions are fighting. But Christians are living our lives as if there is nothing at stake. Most of us will not even talk to anybody about Jesus. Most of us will not sponsor the gospel. Most of us will not use the social media to push the agenda of the gospel. And the enemy, the devil, is using the social media to push his agenda in this world. And they have almost taken over the world. I came to challenge every one of you under the sound of my voice, and I came to wake you up to understand and to be conversant with the fact that there is a battle between light and darkness. And what you have to understand is that the people of darkness are fighting so hard. And so the Bible said that there was a battle between the Philistines and the children of Israel. And the Bible said, a man by the name Goliath of God, he was a champion for the Philistines. God is looking for some terrors in the body of Christ. God is looking for champions in the body of Christ. We are not looking for civilians.
actual loss, the bow down on the land of Scotland and said, "Oh Lord, give me Scotland or I die." I pray that the Lord will give us some passionate people in the church. I pray that the Lord will give us passionate people in King's Court Chapel that will do something for God. Goliath decided to stand for his nation. And you know, when David went to Saul, you know, in attempt to fight Goliath, look at what Saul told David. He said that this guy had been a warrior from his youth. And it is believed by some scholars and some theologians that when Goliath was young, he was devastated by the defeat of his army to the army of Israel. And so when he realized that there was a military sense about him, he decided to distinguish himself to fight for his nation. As little as he was, he decided not to be irresponsible. He decided to develop himself from his youth to fight for his nation. I pray in the mighty name of Jesus that the youth of this church will not waste their youthful age, but they will develop themselves so that they can do something for God. I challenge every young person under the sound of my voice. Didn't give you the sagacity by accident. she wanted to abort me. And my God, so when I heard that, I told myself that, but you give my mother didn't abort me. If the Lord had preserved my life, then I will not be ungrateful to God. I will be grateful to the Lord by preaching His gospel, by being passed in by Him. Me bumpy when you stupid boy, say already I'm not sure. Already Peter, stand up for Him. Already Peter, you be the man. You cannot give Him that job. Just the job to glorify His name in the mighty name of Jesus.
Just give me 3 minutes, I'll be done with you.
Listen to this. Understand that you didn't go there for your children to know how to speak European accent or American accent, but the Lord sent you there as a general, as a missionary, as an ambassador to do something for God. Say, oh, let me help you out now. Go to the butcher. Let the whites send the people out to that place. Know that you believe in the Lord. But it is so sad that most of us, when we are here and we are looking for visa, we can go to Achimata Forest, go to Achia Mountains. And then when the Lord opened the door for us, the moment we sit on the plane, we draw our God through the window. But you see, our brothers, the Muslims, when the leaders of Africa, the leaders of the Eastern world, and go to the Western world, they go with their Muhammad. And that is why they have almost taken over the Western world for God. It will look as if what you are doing doesn't make sense. But this man, no matter